All right, we're at point four in the proper methodology to interpret the Bible. A lot of big words, right? All it means is you want to know what it says, not what somebody else thinks it says, and you have to be accurate with that. And most people, though, don't follow how they learn to read in grammar school. It's the same methodology, but with a little more practice, you have a bigger vocabulary, and you can speak in longer sentences. Nowadays, with the devices, we hardly know what anybody is saying. They say a couple of words in text, and you have to know your person more intimately, but then you limit the people you can speak to about various topics. Anyway, point four, we're studying the Bible to find out if properly interpreted, whether it's reliable at all, because you can read any religious book. And if you read it properly, it doesn't mean it's going to help you or it's saying the truth. So, I maintain, properly interpreted, the Bible is wholly reliable from cover to cover, word to word. But the English translations, whatever, if you're German, so in French, may not, most likely, are not perfect. And the monks over the years, the centuries since the first century and before that, the Jews, but the Jews were very, very diligent of copying their manuscripts. So the Dead Sea Scrolls, what did we learn? Nothing new. That's Hebrew, mostly Hebrew. And the Greek New Testament, that was originally written in Greek because of the manuscript evidence that shows that, a plethora of manuscript evidence that we look at it is in Greek. 55,000 documents, of which most are in Greek. And when we find another language, like Coptic, or German, or French, or whatever, we can look back and say, yeah, this is translated from the Greek. You look at the historicity of it, and also the consistency of it. A number of changes are made, and we looked at that for a while, and we see what manuscript's evidence supports a particular verse. And sometimes there are some differences, but they're almost always nominal. A couple of small things are added, but we can find that out because sometimes several centuries later, like the Johann comma, Johann in his one of his epistles, tries to include some reference as if it's to the Trinity. But that was found in manuscripts that are hundreds and hundreds of years later. And it doesn't make a big difference because that particular passage in the Johann comma wasn't talking about the Trinity. So, and actually confuses, but it really doesn't. It really doesn't. So, we have a very, very, very trustworthy Bible, even when some discrepancies are discovered in the original language and then translated into your versions. And most of the versions are 99.5% corroborative of one another. So, point four, since the interpretation of any passage in the Bible via the proper use of the normative rules of language, context, and logic proves itself to be the most trustworthy, non-contradictory, immutable, consistent interpretation of passages in the Bible. And by the way, the Bible itself, the original language, they're not contradictory either. They're very trustworthy if you knew the original language. You have a good translation? I have some resources, and you've seen them, at Word Search Bible, which is no longer business. They were purchased by another company, but they're not continuing this wonderful resource. So, on the other hand, normative rules permit referral to parallel passages elsewhere in the Bible that corroborate the message in a particular passage that's under review. And when they are stipulated or referred to by the author in order to define specific words or the context of a passage at hand. And parallel passages normatively interpreted may also be used to corroborate the meaning of a passage at hand, but not change it. That means that some additional stuff on that same subject is added in another passage, but you don't have to say or insert it that much. You know, you can draw attention to it, but every time you pick a parallel passage, you have to start at the beginning of the chapter or where the subject has been begun, and then go to the end and walk your way through the passage. If you don't, you're going to give people the impression that you can go all over the Bible and re-editorialize it in your own fashion. A lot of times, your context, they don't match up. They're similar, but not the same. So, since the interpretation of any passage in the Bible via the proper use of the normative rules of language, context, and logic proves itself to be the most trustworthy, non-contradictory, immutable, consistent interpretation of passages in the Bible, then the interpretation by these rules will not be something that can be changed or modified into something different by information derived elsewhere in the Bible or outside of the Bible and still accurately represent the Bible as some contend. You give a person the latitude to make editorial changes from the pulpit. I say if he does that on a regular basis, I'd find another church. Because if you start editorializing in your own mind and not paying attention to context and skimming over passages and going from one spot to the other week after week after week, you're going to be taught a lot of wrong things. So, objectors to this principle of immutability established by the normative rules contend that one cannot just take a particular passage to teach some biblical truth, such as the one which is contained in Ephesians 2, 8 through 10, or John 3, 16, and hundreds of other passages, all of which, properly and normatively interpreted within their own context, teach that believing, a moment of believing, a moment of faith, a moment of trust, synonymous words, faith, trust, believe, in the Son of God, Jesus Christ, results in being saved unto eternal life with the sense that he died for your sins. You believe, you trusted that he died for your sins. You just don't believe Jesus is a good teacher. That's not going to get it, see? So, objectors to this normatively arrived at interpretation falsely maintain that there are other passages throughout the Bible, Old and New Testaments, that teach on salvation unto eternal life and add to what authors Paul, John, and others say a man must do to be saved unto eternal life. This implies that the passages about salvation unto eternal life in Ephesians, John, and in many other books are contradictory, incomplete, with errors of omission when normatively interpreted by themselves within their own particular contexts without being modified to conform with the rest of what they falsely state the Bible teaches via their own methodology of interpretation. But this is an approach to the Bible which would make the understanding of any passage in the Bible unreachable until one had completely mastered every other passage in the Bible, the book of the Bible, which may take a lifetime, and you may not know your whole life that you're saved because you haven't read the whole Bible. And then you have to allow for passages to be modified into their final meanings. Well, so one cannot master the first verse he reads into the Bible until he masters every verse in the Bible beforehand. That's circular reasoning. If this system of interpretation is true, then it would require more than a lifetime of careful study to master the first verse one begins to read in the Bible. Then there is no language that has such a complex structure that can convey such indetermination within each verse so that one might understand that when reading a verse in the Bible, its meaning cannot be determined until every other verse in the Bible is fully mastered. Then, point C, the saints of Old Testament times, since they don't have the new, would not have all the information they needed to be saved unto eternal life. See how ridiculous that is? Because they did not have the completed Bible with the 27 books of the New Testament to study and master. They weren't alive. So Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, David, and Moses, and all the Old Testament saints would have been placed in the condemned part of Hades to perish forever in the lake of fire since they were not provided with New Testament revelation. D. Then the Old Testament, Ephesians, the Gospel of John, every book of the Bible is indeterminate without a full understanding of every other book in the Bible, every passage, every verse, every word. Have you ever met somebody that knew all that? No, I don't. Then the rules to interpret the Bible are beyond the normative rules of language, context, and logic available to all men, with no clear declaration anywhere in the Bible or anywhere else as to what those rules are, as to what each verse's meaning is dependent upon. See how it's sticky wicked, how we go around down the road to disaster. Point F, then this puts the Bible out of reach of mankind, except perhaps the select few who allegedly claim to have a unique special gift from God. No, every single expression, word, and meaning A from cover to cover. Of course, what do you do with the average guy? He's got a job, he's got a family, he's got things to do. You would have to spend 34 hours a day studying the Bible to even come close. But then you're just memorizing. How do you understand what it means? You need resources and teaching. Point G, then God has permitted his word to be indeterminate unless one has been specially given the unique rules of interpreting the Bible and has been supernaturally enabled by God to master every single passage in it and every single word. Point H, then for the most, if not all of mankind, the Bible is impossible to read and therefore it is untrustworthy. Most people don't have that kind of a brilliant mindset, capacity to memorize. On the other hand, just as a cook can follow the directions of a recipe in order to produce the stated result of, for example, an angel food cake, without having to go to another recipe like the one for roast beef, which pastors do all the time. They mix and match their context. So an individual can follow the normative rules of language, context, and logic and read that Ephesians 2:8 and 9, John 3:16, and hundreds of other verses stipulate within their own particular context that believing, a moment of believing in the Son of God, Jesus Christ, results in being saved unto eternal life without having to go to other alleged passages which might add corrections and or directions, even if there were any in the Bible and there are none. In this manner, one can relatively quickly and easily discern the teachings and build an understanding of the Bible by simply studying one passage at a time, following the normative rules of interpretation, without years of agonizing examination of the Bible, the entire Bible. Thereby, one can determine what the Bible is saying one passage at a time. Now, passages in the Bible, by and large, declare a clear message of what they mean by themselves, or at times with the use of one or more parallel passages that are stipulated or referred to as cross-references by the original author in the passage at hand in order to provide definitions of terms or to help define the context of the original passage. That's rare. According to the normative rules of language, context, and logic, further investigation of parallel passages, those with sufficiently matching contexts, often provide the same message corroborating the original passage, but without additional essential information needed to be gleaned for the interpretation of the original passage or needed to be added to it. How about the word repent? How many people have told me you have to repent in order to have eternal life? And I say, what do you mean by repent? It means turn from sin. Does it always mean that? John 3:16 is repentance there. The word isn't there, but the concept is, for God so loved the world, as is occupied, every man, woman, and child who will ever be conceived and born, or just conceived. And so, God so loved the world, but all of them are not necessarily believers. Especially you and I started out as unbelievers. Up to the point I was 17, I was an unbeliever. So, the problem with that is, those are sinners and limited in their capacity to read, but yet God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, and the context is for your sins. And whosoever is the believing one in that. So, when you became a believer when I was 17, guess what? I repented. But I didn't turn from my sins because the context doesn't allow for that. So what I did do is turn from not believing to believing. That's a change of mind. Meta, change, noia, mind, the Greek word for believe. Or pistis, believe. So you change the mind, meta, noia. Change the mind about believing. From not believing. Finally, when properly analyzed in detail in accordance with the normative rules, there simply are no contradictory passages so far that I've found anywhere in the Bible or any passages that need correction. How many people want to editorialize? They go all over the place and they give you the presumption of what the context is without properly and academically explaining it. That's how you learn to read in school. And the more you went to school, elementary, junior high, high school, college, graduate, you learn to develop your understanding. Finally, when properly analyzed in detail in the